Hi, Clif.
Hi, Liz.
Clif, you cover some of our biggest technology clients in Europe. What does the tech landscape in Europe look like right now?
We're seeing a lot of interesting things in technology in Europe. And the first thing I would say is most of our companies that we cover, and we cover the vast majority of large technology companies in Europe, we've seen them really react to this crisis in a pretty exceptional way. They've been able to move to a working from home scenario very quickly and with minimal impact to their business. And that's really because those businesses have been stitched together with technology already. They're mostly working on software systems that are built for collaboration and for mobile working. And so those companies have adjusted very well. I would say the other thing that's really impacting European technology companies is really just this crisis is accelerating trends that we've been seeing playing out in the marketplace for a number of years. And this current situation is just accelerating those.
And what are those trends?
There's really three that come to mind for me. The first is really the basic one of online replacing offline transactions. And nowhere has that played out more than in just e-commerce. So your average horizontal e-commerce provider, basically the Amazon equivalent in every country, is seeing a resurgence in its business as people move to buying goods and having them delivered to their home. The second big trend is really collaboration software. And so we're on Zoom right now, and I'm sure you, like I, are doing 5 to 7 Zoom calls a day. But it's not only Zoom, it's every other piece of software that's out there that allows companies and people to interact, exchange data, exchange ideas. And the third trend is really digitalization of content. And so the basic thing and what we're all experiencing is a increased usage of things like Netflix, Disney Plus, and those types of applications. But you could take it a step further and look at online gaming. In Europe, we have a number of public and private online gaming companies who've seen a significant benefit to their business. And I'm sure, Liz, maybe your kids like mine are doing that instead of their online schooling at the current moment. But you have that. You could take it even a step further to online betting companies who, even though there's barely any sports on at the current moment, they're still finding a way to allow people to place bets, in particular in Europe.
Clif, technology companies have traditionally played a smaller role in the public markets in Europe than in the US, but do you see that changing?
Traditionally, European technology has been underweighted in the public markets relative to what we see in the US. So for example, in the Euro Stoxx 600 index, only 13% of companies have a growth rate of 10% or more. If you looked at a similar statistic in the United States, that number would be 30 to 40%. So much more growth and really much more technology when you look at the US capital markets. The good news is that trend is changing, and it's really being driven by two things. The first is there have been a number of really world-class companies based in Europe who have listed in the last 5 to 6 years. So companies like Spotify, Farfetch, Delivery Hero, Adyen, these are companies that are world-class in their specific sectors. They've listed, they're continuing to move that trend towards public access to technology and to growth. And the second thing that's happening is a surge in the formation of private technology companies. So for example, in 2010, there were single digits number of unicorns. So technology companies that were worth $1 billion or more. In 2015, that number was 22. And in the last statistics that we've seen, that number is basically just under 100. It's 98 or 99 as of the end of last year. And so there's been this huge growth in the number of private technology companies. And that's really coincided with the amount of funding that's available for those companies, going from 10 billion in 2015 to 30 billion last year.
So what's driving this momentum?
There's really three drivers of why technology and why private company formation in Europe is accelerating. The first is there are a number of European technologists who have either been successful entrepreneurs in the US or other places, or have worked in very senior jobs in global technology companies. They've come home to Europe and decided to become an entrepreneur and have brought their network and their ecosystem to Europe and started companies here. The second is an influx of capital, mostly European-based venture capital that wasn't around in such size 5 to 10 years ago, but now has become very large and is there to really fund European technology companies as they grow. And the third trend is really just a psychological one, which is entrepreneurs in Europe have become to really dream bigger about what they want to become and how big their companies should be. And so instead of traditionally selling out at a 200 to 300 million valuation to some global company that comes around, they have decided to really become large global businesses, and they know they can do that from Europe now.
So from your vantage point in investment banking, what impact do you think these trends might have on deal activity in the months ahead?
What's amazing within technology generally, globally, and particularly in Europe, is we may remain really busy, and our clients are looking to do transactions and are very active both from a financing standpoint and also from a strategic standpoint. What we've seen transpire is really three waves. The first wave since the onslaught of COVID was really defensive. So companies that needed capital quickly, and in particular public companies, went and raised that capital almost immediately or within a few weeks of the crisis coming around. And those would be, you know, more leisure or travel oriented companies that have a big have been impacted in a major way from the situation. The second wave was more opportunistic capital raises. And so those are companies that actually had fared pretty well during the crisis, but wanted to take an opportunity of the markets being open to access capital that they probably would have accessed anyway, but it was available to them and at less dilution than they had seen previously. And so a number of those companies went and raised primary capital to really do strategic things. And the last wave, and really what we've seen in the last 4 to 5 weeks, is a pickup in strategic activity, and that hasn't manifested itself in M&A or merger transactions being announced or other strategic activity yet, but I think the momentum is there in terms of companies wanting to do strategic transactions and grow their businesses during this period of time.
Thanks, Cliff.
Thanks, Liz.